Hello fellow viewers and welcome to yet another VATSIM Emergency. Today we'll lose our main navigation instruments, leaving us flying almost blind. Both the primary flight displays and the navigation displays are vital for normal navigation, so what do we do when these fail? Before we'll get in the soup, we'll just have a brief overlook of the inertial reference system, or otherwise referred to as the IRSs. The IRS exists of different motion sensors and rotation sensors consisting of accelerometers and gyroscope to continually calculate the present position of the airplane. The IRS feeds the airplane with information about its acceleration, vertical speed, attitude, true and magnetic heading, ground speed, track, present position and wind data. On the Boeing 737, two IRSs are installed, working independent, meaning that they both have to go through an alignment process in order to provide accurate information. The length of the alignment procedure varies depending on the latitude location. For instance, the alignment procedure at equator takes 5 minutes, whereas it can take as much as 20 minutes close to the poles. The reason why this depends on latitude location is because the IRS actually uses the Earth rotation to align. If the airplane points due north, the IRS will feel a slight bank to the right, and if the airplane points due east, the IRS will feel a slight downwards movement of the pitch. The relative movement of Earth is slower at the poles because we are closer to the center of rotation, meaning that the change of attitude is slower, making it harder for the IRS to detect, thus making the alignment procedure longer. Now that the IRS alignment is complete, all our navigation instruments will power up and all lights on the IRS panel should be extinguished. After a long flight, small precision errors will accumulate. As we see here, the two IRSs tells us slightly different coordinates to be our current location. To correct this, a quick align can be performed by turning the knob from nav to align and then back to nav. This way, the IRS won't have to go through the full alignment procedure, but just a smaller one taking approximately 30 seconds and allowing us once again to tell the IRSs our current location. If an IRS fails, setting them up to the attitude mode can potentially regain altitude and heading information. Another way to deal with an IRS failure is to set the remaining working IRS to feed both pilot navigation instruments, instead of the normal configuration where the left and right IRS provide data to the captain and first officer's instruments respectively. Now that we have had a brief overview of the IRSs on the Boeing 737, we'll simulate a failure in flight and see what we can do about it. Without further ado, let's jump on board on Nor Shuttle 619 on its last leg to Arlanda Stockholm Airport in Sweden. At this time, we have initiated our descent into Arlanda on the Nigel 1 Tango arrival. The landing data and speed calculated and the briefing completed. All in all, we are well prepared for today's approach. The PFD have just planked out and the same for the ND, autopilot has disengaged, I have control. IRS master caution has been triggered, checking on the first officer's displays, all looking good there. Going to the IRS panel and obviously we have some kind of failure on my side. For now we'll just make a quick fix by setting the right IRS to feed all instruments, setting the seatbelt signs to on just as a precaution. And we now see that our instruments once again are provided with information. We do have a warning instrument switch just to alert us that some switches are in a non-normal configuration, which is okay. Okay, again we have lost information to the PFD and the ND, this time includes the first officer's displays as well. Taking a look on the IRS panel again, both IRSs has failed now and none of them gives any data. So what now? We now have to rely solely on the ISFD, the integrated standby flight display. This little box is fully independent from the two other IRSs, except that its heading information is provided from the captain's IRS, which has failed. We therefore have to use a standby magnetic compass placed in the beginning of the overhead panel. Before we'll further troubleshoot the problem, we'll just advise ATC of our situation, explaining that we are no longer capable of following the star. Pan pan, Nor Shuttle 619, and we have lost our main navigation instruments, requesting vectors for now on.
Nor Shuttle 619, fly heading 020, vector ILS 26.
Right heading 020, vectors for the ILS 26, Nor Shuttle 619, thank you. We'll now continue troubleshooting our problem by pulling up the quick reference handbook, finding the page IRS fault. Condition: One or more of these occur, an IRS fault occurs. That's checked, so we'll go to step 1. Choose one, on the ground or in flight. We are in flight, so we'll go to step 6. In flight. The IRS attitude and slash or the nav modes may be inoperative. So that's just telling us that the IRS, which has failed, may be useless from now on. However, point 7, partial capability may be restored by selecting the attitude mode on the failed IRS. Straight and level flight, constant airspeed, flight must be maintained for at least 30 seconds. Going to step 8. Selecting attitude mode on the failed IRS is desired. Selecting attitude mode on the failed IRS is not desired. We would like to try and restore the IRS in attitude mode, so we'll go to step 9. Do the next step only if the captain or first officer's primary attitude display is failed. Well, both attitude displays has failed, so we'll continue to step 10, alerting us that this action is not reversible. IRS mode selected on the failed side. Confirm to attitude. We'll set a timer and wait 30 seconds to see if anything happens. Meanwhile, we'll just read the note on the button. The primary attitude display will stay failed, and the set IRS heading prompt will not appear on the position initialization page until the attitude mode alignment is complete. Okay, that's checked, so we'll just wait till 30 seconds has passed to see if we have any recovery.
Nor Shuttle 619, descend flight level 70.
Descending to flight level 704, Nor Shuttle 619. And there we go, 30 seconds have passed, taking a look on the overhead panel. We still have two fault light illuminated, so none of the IRS is recovered. Continuing with the QH. Point 11, choose one. Fault light extinguished, fault light stays illuminated. We'll go to step 13. IRS transfer switch, both on left or both on right. Note, autopilot cannot be engaged. Because of both IRSs has failed on us today, we'll have to use the standby flight display and the magnetic compass as guidance. Now that we're coming through 10,000 feet, we'll just put on the lights, the engine start switches, runway turnoffs, taxi lights, logo and wing, shining bright as a Christmas tree. Check-in seatbelt signs are on, hydraulics looking good, pressurization, the inner dial should be at 1,000 feet and the outer approximately 4 when passing through 10,000 feet, looking good. Packs are in auto, bleeds are on engine, landing altitude is set 150 feet. And as we were looking up there, the heading got a little away from us, so we'll just make a slight left turn to get back onto heading 020. And we'll just take over manual controls of the throttle as well, putting them to idle, speeding up the descent rate a bit. So we'll call for the descent checklist. Pressurization checked, landing altitude set 150 feet. Auto brake set to 2. Landing data. VRF speed is 146 knots, decision altitude is 301 feet barometric, both set and indicated in the PFD. Recall, we have an IRS fault, which we are well aware of, but we can't really do much about it. Approach briefing is complete, which completes the descent checklist.
Nor Shuttle 619, turn left heading 010.
Left heading 010, Nor Shuttle 619. As you'll see here, it is pretty hard to coordinate one's turns with the magnetic compass, because as I change the bank angle, the indicated heading on the compass changes as well. As I made this bank, the magnetic compass added approximately 15 degrees to the heading, and because ATC told us to fly on a heading of 010 degrees, we will roll out when the compass indicates 025 degrees. And we see that the speed is actually coming up here, so we'll just increase the pitch attitude to slow it down, setting the speed back to 240 knots initially. Heading is pretty much 25 degrees now, so we'll try roll out. Well, we are more or less spot on, but we can just make some minor correction to adjust.
Nor Shuttle 619, descend altitude 5,000 feet, QNH 1023.
Down to 5,000 feet on QNH 1023, Nor Shuttle 619. As we got clear below the flight levels, we will execute the approach checklist. Altimeters is set, QNH 1023, approach checklist complete. We'll just notify the attendants that we are going to land shortly, so that they can begin and secure the cabin for a safe landing. Now that the navigation display has failed, visual reference has gotten an even bigger role. I know that the airport should be off to the left of us, so we'll just have a glance look to see if the runway lights can be spotted. For now we can't really see them, but it's probably because they are behind the clouds. Pretty much dead ahead of us, there is a good layer of clouds, which is going to be quite interesting to go through, taking into account that we have to solely rely on the standby flight display, which is kind of hard to see because it's very small. Another thing we should have in mind flying in precipitation weather, like clouds, is to fight the ice from building up on the wings or in the engine cowls. The outside air temperature is well below 10 degrees Celsius, which is why I flick on the engine anti-ice switches, to prevent any ice from building up. Smaller snowflakes do not harm the engine the least, but if ice build up on the cowls and suddenly crack off into the engines, these larger pieces of snow can pretty much easily destroy an engine. By putting the engine anti-ice switches to on, the hot bleed air will be directed to the engine cowls, warming them and preventing any ice to stick. On the other hand, wing anti-ice is normally only used when visual ice builds up on the wings. Not that it isn't a very dangerous thing, and pilots should always be aware if they move into icing conditions.
Nor Shuttle 619er, descend altitude 2500 feet.
Descending to 2500 feet, Nor Shuttle 619er. We're really in the soup at the moment and pretty much all visual reference is lost. But as long as I have a good focus down on the ISFD, everything should be just fine. Based on our descent clearance to 2500 feet, which is the high we'll capture the glide slope at, I assume our ILS interception is coming up soon, telling us that we need to slow down and deploy some flaps. We're below 250 knots at the time, so flaps may be lowered to 1, scrolling the speed bug along to flaps 1 maneuvering speed. Flaps on transit. Flaps 1 green light.
North of the 619er, turn left heading 340.
Left heading 340, Nautical 619er. Trying to coordinate my turns once again, same method, adding approximately 15 degrees to the compass before I roll out.
Nor Shuttle 619er, turn left heading 280, clear ILS approach, runway 26.
Left heading 280, clear ILS, runway 264, Nor Shuttle 619er. So, last turn coming up, speed is slightly high.
Nor Shuttle 109er,
just wondering if I changed the ND to the plan. No, still can't show current position, of course, leaving it on the approach screen. Localizer alive. Increasing bank. But it seems like we'll overshoot. So what we'll do is just continue our turn until we are on the interception heading from the opposite side. We are visual with the runway as well, so that's pretty good. Speed is still high. Putting down the gear to increase the drag. Speed decreasing. For now we'll just stay on the glide path while we bleed off some airspeed, and when the speed allows we will eventually go flaps 5 to further deaccelerate. Setting flaps 5. Setting flaps 5 maneuvering speed. And we'll continue to flaps 15 plus the speed. Arming the speed brake. Coming through 2500 feet, more or less on the localizer as well as glide path. Setting flap 30.
North Shuttle 619er, runway 26, clear to land, the wind 300 degrees, 4 knots.
Clear to land, runway 26, North Shuttle 619er. We're fully configured and stable on the approach, so we'll call for the landing checklist. engine start switches, they are both in continuous, speed brakes, armed green light, landing gear down, indicating 3 green, flaps set and indicated 30 green light, landing checklist is complete. Speed tape warning us not to go any slower, but this might be because of the failed IRS. Just double checking the gross weight, which is good, we are within safe landing limits. And it seems like there's a slight bug on the scenery so that the runway lights do not illuminate, but we'll just ignore that for today. Coming in on minimums.
Minimums.
Continue.
100. 50. 30.
Gentle 20, flare.
10.
And we're down. Speed brake up. I'll reverse. Auto brake system is normal. Deaccelerating. Knots. 80 knots. Out of reverse, taking over manual control of the brakes as well. And here we go through 60 knots. Well, we are back on the ground again and executed today's failure very successfully, doing the appropriate actions. So, thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed, please take the 1 second to hit that like button, it is very appreciated. And as always, if you have any question whatsoever, please do not hesitate to leave a comment below, and I'll try my best to answer any question. But that about wraps it up. Once again, very much thank you for watching, and if you haven't seen my previous episode yet, be my guest to click on the screen now.